So, good morning once again. Today, the idea of this last session is to bring you a little bit more close to our current development. Also, what we have discussed so far was ja ADFT and ADPT. I would say these are, so to speak, development platforms that are well established and also in a stage where it is relatively straightforward to add something new on top of them, like what I showed you yesterday, the hybrid functionals into ADPT. Today I'm talking about QMMM in density functional theory. If you look in the literature, QMMM is a huge area, or has become a huge area in the last, I would say, 10 years or so. It culminated with the Nobel Prize awarding to Kaplus and Warschel and Levitt, I think. In particular, André Warschel was the person, or is the person of this group, who has promoted QMMM. And this is, I believe, of course, the reason why there is quite a bit of activity in this field. As usual, I have a subtitle, and this is how we would like to use QMMM. In our development work, what we are doing in the moment, we would like to use QMMM in order to develop an atomistic solvation model. This is an idea we actually pursue since long, and one must admit this little success also, namely to bring our QM calculations into an environment that really becomes microscopic, so that really is an environment where we have length scales of many nanometers in three dimensions. That means in terms of atoms that these atomistic models will usually represent, let's say, at least 50,000 atoms or maybe even 100,000 atoms. These system sizes are in the moment for QM basically impossible to reach, and this is the motivation to combine QM with molecular mechanics. So here's an outline of these kind of work. I mean, we have, I will give you an introduction and particular the main aims we are looking at, that are not the only aims, of course, for QMMM implementations. I then talk a little bit about how QMMM is implemented in DMON2K. In this case, we do have one program, which is DMON, and it has a QM driver and an MM driver inside. That is different to most other QMMM implementation, where you have a script, and the script is calling a QM program and it is calling an MM program. These kind of QMMM implementations are also existing with DMON. For example, there is a DMON implementation in CHARM, or there are QMMM scripts that are using DMON as a QM program. But this is not what I'm talking about. I'm really talking about a QMMM implementation inside DMON. So there is no scripting involved. The advantage of this is that you, of course, can now combine best performance from the QM and the MM world. Where we want to go is free energy gradients, and that is our ultimate goal, our ultimate aim, and this is also why Juan Diego is co-author of this presentation, because that is really Juan Diego's PhD work, and I will show you a little bit about this free energy gradients, because they're an approach to go to free energy that has until now only very little bit, only very little been explored. And usually if you talk about free energy calculations in the framework of molecular simulations, you will end up in a molecular dynamics simulation. Free energy gradients also will need molecular dynamics simulations, but particularly the connection between then the MM part and the QM part is interesting. I'm then showing you developments we have to do in order to implement these free energy gradients. One is the cyclic cluster model. That is an approach also for that in principle can be used for periodic system calculation. It has the advantage and disadvantage, one has to say, that it doesn't use a periodic potential. It implements periodicity by an interaction scheme and not by the explicit potential. This has certain advantages and of course also certain disadvantages. And then I would like to talk about where we are in the moment. We are implementing a barostat for QMMM simulations using the so-called Liouville formalism. That is more, honestly speaking, molecular mechanics development as it is quantum mechanics development in this moment. I then have a large part also about transition state search algorithms. I remember that you have done something like this also in the hand-on sessions, some on you, of you, and I would like to elaborate a little bit more in this point, because that is also a development point that is now not so directly related to the implementation of the first principle methodology, but it is, so to speak, a utility tool that is absolutely necessary if you want to make meaningful calculations for chemical reactions. So again, a picture of a DEMON meeting. This was the meeting in France last year. And again, here, the funding agencies that I acknowledge very much for the continuous support. Okay, this is where we want to go. We want to go to solution chemistry. Our particular interest is there in solution chemistry in the specific mechanism, in particular how the solvent environment influences the mechanism of a chemical reaction. A prototype of such a situation is this change of nuclear as a substitution reactions that can be second order if you do them, for example, in a gas phase or in a nonpolar solvent, and that become first order if you do it in a protic solvent. So these change of the reaction mechanism obviously involve the presence of solvent molecules inside or around the transition state. And that is something we are aiming to understand, and we would like to develop a methodology where in the computational simulations you can change the solvent so that you can see how reaction mechanisms are changing, and so how you can use the solvent, so to speak, to obtain desired reaction products. That is a qualitative level of understanding. Quantitatively, this involves, of course, reaction energetics. So in form of the reaction energy and in form of the reaction barrier. And particularly for the calculation of reaction barriers, you need to find transition states, and that is the reason why this presentation will also have a good part on transition state finding algorithms and transition state finding strategies. The last part, which is little, honestly speaking, understood from a theoretical point of view, is the solvent structure by itself when you do a reaction or when something happens to the solute. And this is something that has been experimentally anticipated, I would like to say, since many years. If you look in a textbook of organic chemistry, you will find there always chapters about how solvent influences the existence of, for example, tautomeric structures, how solvent influences the pKa of substances, and so on and so on and so on. Theoretically, this has been little investigated, and it is a tough problem because entropic effects will play here a major role, very similar as what I have shown you for the melting process of molecules, where also entropic effects are probably more important, or at least as important, let's say it so, as energetic effects. I don't think one can say more or less, but that these two effects are coming now together. And that means in order to catch these entropic effects, you need samplings, you need many, many structures, and you need somehow to take into account the dynamics of your whole system. Yeah, here's a schematic part. For example, aptamers are something that is quite interesting because they are on a size we can calculate quantum mechanically, and their structure is very different in different solvents. And last but not least, I want to share this picture with you. This is an industrial robot which comes from KUKA. This is a robot factory actually for the car industry. But this is an industrial robot that has been changed into a machine now that can do massive chemical reaction analysis. And what I also find really interesting is I picked this picture not from a scientific publication or so, but from a daily newspaper in Germany. And it was brought in the context of what they call Industry 2.0, that a lot of, even highly qualified toolsmen work, like this here for a trained chemical assistant, in the future will be probably taken over by automatic machines. And if you look in the car industry, if you today see assembling lines that maybe some 50 or 60 years ago have given work to 5,000 workers, they now are giving work to maybe 50 workers or even less, for example, with VW. So this is also something we must take into account in our educational process, that we are aware of that there is a large wave of automatization coming now into, let's say, chemistry, and I think also experimental physics. So let me talk a little bit about phenomenological description of solvation. So you have this picture here. Here on the left-hand side, you have a methane molecule that is isolated in the gas phase. And now you can imagine a process were solvent molecules. Here, for example, water molecules are assembling around these single molecule. So in this part, if you have these few water molecules, the system will be still in the gas phase. And in fact, such kind of molecule water assemblings, sometimes one can also call them clathrates, they are subjects of studies in the gas phase, where you can look at such isolated system. Maybe not now with methane, but if you have, for example, here a gold cation or some other cation, then these things can be looked in the gas phase, and the, for example, binding energy of individual waters around these single units, this molecule or ion, can be investigated experimentally by collision-induced dissociation experiments. Of course, it is then so that you will see that the inner waters will bind more strong to this solute here than the outer waters. And at a point, the binding of these outer waters will be so weak when you increase the system that you are at an energy level that is so low that in the gas phase, the water simply here outside will evaporate. In the moment, but this is under ultra high vacuum conditions, in the moment you could put pressure on the system, then these kind of assemblies will remain together, and at the end you will have indeed a solution of this methane in water. Now, if you look at the phenomenological thermodynamics that describes this process, you have several phenomenological laws for that. You have solvation and activation coefficients, you have solvation free energies. All of that looks at a system, or at an idealized system, where you have one molecule of your solute, in this case the methane, in an environment of an infinite amount of solvents, in this case of water. So if you look at these tables, which you can find in engineering books, that is the idealized reference, and then you can have, changes in this in order to change the concentration. You have concentration dependencies, but be careful, these concentration dependencies are coming in form of activity coefficients. So they are not coming in directly in terms of the concentration of the solute, but the situation, the free energy and so, changes per particle with the number of particles you have in the system. So it's a highly non-linear situation. So then let us see what is current state of the art for quantum chemical descriptions of molecules in solution. And I think it is fair to say that the current state of the art is what is called in the literature PCM, polarizable continuum model. Here, the idea is that the solute, this is a molecule inside this cavity, is a quantum mechanical structure that is also then calculated with a quantum chemical program. So call it Demon, call it Gaussian, call it as you wish. And the solvent is represented, however, in a non-atomistic way by an infinite medium. This is why it is called continuum, but that has no structure, but that is polarizable by these solute molecules. Despite really the relative elementary and maybe even primitive physical picture this model represents, it serves extremely well If you look at changes in solvent polarity, this is what this slide here shows. That is the shift in polarity in a kind of solvent. So if you, for example, go from a solvent that is CH4, also you start with methane, but now as a solvent, and you go to CCl4, tetrachlorocarbon, then you change polarity in the solvent, and these can be expressed very nicely with such an approach. However, it fails completely if you go from a completely unpolar solvent like CH4 to a polar solvent, let's say water. In that moment, this approach fails completely. And so these limitations are well known, and one of the ideas is to overcome these limitations is to substitute these continuum which you have here outside by an atomistic description. And that is the idea basically of a QMMM solvent model as an alternative. Honestly speaking, at this stage of development, we really don't know how good such QMMM alternative is. In fact, there are some experimental calculations in the literature about hydration energies that are mostly done in the framework of MM programs. So also programs like CHARM or like LAMMPS or other kind of empirical force field. NAMPT is another one, GROMAX, I mean there are many that are empirical force field programs. So when there was the idea of QMMM, one of the first things this community tried was to use QM ions in MM solvents and calculate solvation energies. And the results, one must say, are very disappointing. They are much, much worse than the results from a PCM model. So this is why I have put here, behind this alternative, still a question mark. It is absolutely at this moment not sure how good QMMM really will work as an alternative to PCM. The basic idea is rather simple. You take your solvent, for example, in this case here, the solvent is this water system, and you describe this water system in terms of molecular mechanics. And now you combine this solvent in molecular mechanics with your solute in quantum mechanics. And then you would get the QMMM description in this form. As I have said, this kind of approach has so far not been super successful. It has the advantage that it does not need any kind of capping potentials or link atoms. So the interface, which is usually considered the difficult part between QM and MM, is in fact here not really problematic, at least not from an elementary theoretical point of view. You have no dangling bonds. So why are these kind of approaches so far not really so successful? The idea really is that it is a very, crude approximation to put MM waters around QM, particularly if this QM is in some form charged or has a strong dipole moment or something like this. So the idea which we are thinking to pursue is, instead of using this elementary approach, we will use here a QM system that is surrounded by water. And this is QM water. And then the interface between the QM system and the MM system is not between the solute and the solvent, but the interface is between QM solvent, the QM waters around here, and the MM solvent from this environment. And these solvent-solvent interface or interactions, we hope that we can parametrize them quite good. And then we hope that we get good solvation energies. Okay, so this is basically the outline where we want to go, and these are the objectives we want to achieve. As I told you already, qualitatively, we are really interested in reaction mechanisms in solutions. And I think we have at least very fundamental, very first indications that this qualitative goal we can reach. That there I'm really quite optimistic. Quantitatively, and this is really the challenge, is we want to calculate solvation. We will at the beginning only restrict ourselves to water, so hydration. We want to calculate hydration energies for systems in water. And here I have to say that the PCM is parameterized, heavily parameterized, for obtaining such hydration energies. And it does an extremely good job. It calculates your hydration energies if it is a system that can be calculated with PCM. It calculates you this hydration energies to accuracies within a few kilocalories per mole. Anything calculated so far with QMMM approach shows errors in the range of 50 to 100 kilocalories per mole, only to give you an impression what is the difference here. So PCM really calculates very good hydration energies if the system setup is PCM adequate. And this is exactly our benchmark. We want for exactly these systems that are PCM adequate obtain hydration energies of the same quality, but now with a QMMM approach. Of course, there are many, many other kind of objectives or of scientific goals that you can reach here and also on this side. But we are in the moment only focusing on these first two because we are at an early stage of development. So let me show you now about the QMMM implementation in DMON2K in a form that is more on a hierarchical level. So let us look at again at this part here where we have the different theoretical methodologies for the different length scales and also for the different time scales. That is here very important. So what I have shown you in the last two sessions is that with the development of ADFT, we have moved the first principle methodology on a length scale of, let's say, a nanometer. So for systems like these kind of insulin parts or the COVID-19 proteases, so systems that have 1,000 and more atoms. On the other side, we also have moved the time scale for molecular dynamics simulations, where we start with time steps that are in the range of femtoseconds to the nanosecond time scale, that means to millions of these time steps. So this is a development that is QM characteristic for DMON2K. And what we want to do now with the QMMM is to enlarge this here to system sizes where we have many nanometers yeah, let's say 10 nanometers in dimensions, and where we have atomic numbers that are something like, let's say, 100,000. Then a typical setup would be that we have a quantum mechanical region, a region with 5,000 quantum mechanical atoms, and an MM region with 95,000 MM atoms. That would be the aim of such a QMMM simulation ultimately. And another point, I think, which is very important if we want to go to reactions, if we want to have reliable activation energies, we need inside the QM part to have a subsection that we can treat on a really high theoretical level of theory. In the moment, that would be for us hybrid functionals. We have already seen for gas phase reactions that these hybrid functionals produce activation barriers and reaction energies in accuracies that are really becoming interesting for chemistry, so that we have activation barriers with errors of, let's say, 1-2 kilocalories per mole. If we can give such predictions to experimentalists, they will listen. They will say, oh yeah, that is something that is really relevant for the experiment. So basically, we have this battle on two fronts. One side is the accuracy of a small part of the QM region, and the other part is the size for the QMMM part. And we are focusing in the moment on the QMMM part. So this is how the implementation in Demon2K looks like. Now, so far we have only discussed this energy, which is the QM energy. This energy in a QMMM calculation is now augmented by the mechanical interaction energy between the QM part and the MM part. This energy basically ensures that the two kind of atoms, if you have a QM atom on one side and MM atom on the other side, that they do not collapse into each other. Then we have the intrinsic MM energy. This is the energy of the force field we are using. Everything I'm showing you in the moment is OPLS. That is the force field we have implemented in Demon. We can also use AMBA, but the force fields we are using in the moment, they are all force fields that are not polarizable. There are some works going on. The polarizable force fields are now brought into Demon2K and something like amoeba and so, but this is not really of interest to us in the moment. So we use a rather simple, easy force field. And this is a nuclear-nuclear repulsion energy that also now changes due to the MM embedding. And this is basically what is shown here down. That is a QM energy expression that looks like the energy expressions we have discussed the days before. But the change is really here in these core Hamiltonian. You see here is the augmented QMMM core Hamiltonian. This is the traditional QM part. And here now you have a new interaction where the density, so to speak, or the orbitals in this, we are at the Hamiltonian, so are the orbitals, mu and nu are the atomic orbitals inside the QM regions, but these orbitals now interact electrostatically with the point charge and of the MM system. And here, for example, if you would have a polarizable force field, you would have here not only a charge term, but you also would have here dipole terms, atomic dipole moments that come from the MM force field. Yeah. So you see the sums. This is the sum over the QM region. That is always the sum over the small number of atoms. So as I told you, a few hundreds, a few thousand atoms. And this is the sum over the MM region. This is the sum over a large number of atoms. So 10,000 to 100,000 atoms. And you see also that in the nuclear repulsion energy, you have a modification. This here is the original QM nuclear repulsion energy, and this is now augmented by an QMMM repulsion energy. But this is not really a big issue because it is something of point charge interactions. So this here is our first problem we encountered. You see here a QM system, relatively small. This is from some 5 years ago or even more. This QM system is some kind of organic system. It's actually a cutout of a large protein. So it might have 100 atoms. And you embed this into these kind of atomic charges, which you have here. And now you make this embedding larger and larger and larger. And as long as you are dealing with these kind of system sizes, the problem is not really significant. But if you want to go to large systems, this here was in work in CHARM, where Demon was coupled to CHARM. So at the end, the whole system had 300, almost 350,000 atoms. This is Ray who did these calculations. And what you see here is that this is at the end the protein. Yeah, so this is the QMMM protein. This is the QM region of the protein. This is the QMMM protein. And this surrounding here is water, which you have. And all of that, all this, what is here in this ochre color, is calculated MM, and only this small part is calculated QM. But all these point charges you have out here, they are interacting with this QM system. And so you are starting to get a problem inside this embedding sum that comes from the MM system. So as I showed you, this embedding charge is now here rewritten. A and B are atomic orbitals inside the QM system. AD0 is the 1 over R operator, where D is the position of an MM atom, and R is the position of the electron inside the QM atom. This is written in this form because you then can easily extend to higher moments, so for polarizable force fields. Now, the main point or the main idea is that you can separate this sum into a near field sum, where these are the MM centers that are near to the QM region, and a far field sum, where these are far away, also MM centers that are far away from the quantum mechanical region. And of course, the idea is that inside this blue sum here, there are only a few MM centers, and most of the MM centers are in this far field region. And now the idea is that for this far field region, we can introduce an alternative calculation of this molecular integral. Look at this. This is a molecular integral that has three centers. It has center A and center B inside the QM region, but it has center D outside the QM region. And the number, once again, of these D centers can become very large, some hundred thousands or more. So we are here again performing an asymptotic expansion that is an asymptotic expansion based on the underlying Boyce function. And the main issue here is that this integral can then be expressed in a form of an integral that only depends from the QM centers, A and B. This is a type of overlap integral. And another form here that has no dependency whatsoever any longer from the quantum mechanical description. There are no orbitals here. This is the charge of the MM atom, and this here TAD is this kind of generalized 1 over R operator. Yeah, but this is only acting on atoms. It does not act on orbitals. So the scaling of this far field part here that goes into this far field sum is a scaling that is typically for MM methodologies multiplied by something overlap type integral for the QM region. But the important point is this multiplication. So this part can be calculated independently from this part. So this separation is the key of success to have a fast calculation for these far field embedding sums. And here you see the effect on these. Down here are the number of embedding charges. These are in principle the number of MM atoms. This is the time you need for the calculation of these embedding term if you do the standard calculation. And if you then use the far field expansion, this time goes down to these values down here. And now a good thing is that this is extremely well parallelizable. So if you parallelize with 16 cores, you get this here. So you basically eliminate this computational task in your calculation. And of course, if you go to larger systems, so these are here the 350,000 embedding charges Ray was using, then this new methodology that was originally developed by Alvaro reduces the time for the calculation of these integrals from 7,500 seconds to something that is well below 200 seconds. So it's a large factor, and it is very important to do if you want to go to these large QM MM systems, large in this sense here with a large MM embedding. Okay, so this is the part we had to discuss for the QM energy calculations. Now the parts for the QM MN and MM energy calculations or energy expressions is much simpler. The mechanical interaction between QM MM is expressed in terms of such a Lennard-Jones potential, where you do have here an attractive part and a repulsive part. And these parameters which you have here, these are atomic radii combinations, and these are potential well deeps, depths. They are taken from the force field you are using for MM. So you're taking these force field parameters and also assign them to QM atoms in order to have these QMMM energy expression. Then for the MM energy expression, this is a typical part of very simple formulas, most often harmonic potentials, and then long-range interaction potentials in form, again, of the Lennard-Jones. This is here used for the van der Waals interaction. It's the same approach, only that here you have interactions between a MM atom D and a QM atom A, and here you have interactions between two MM atoms, but you have parameters for that here inside the force field, and you have the Coulomb potential for that. So I would like to show you an example for this kind of QMMM implementation in Demon 2K. And this is something I think the people who have been in the hand-on session, they know this already. This is glycine. And this is glycine in the gas phase, but it is not glycine in the gas phase as you would expect to be from a chemical point of view. Instead, what you have here, the carbonyl group, this is the COO group here, the carbonyl group is missing a proton. So it's a deprotonated carbonyl group here on the left-hand side. And the missing proton of this carbonyl group has been moved by hand as a starting structure to the amine group, which is now an ammonium group. So it has a proton here too much. So if you think about that in terms of charge, you have a negative charge here, partial negative charge, and you have a partial positive charge here. So this is a typical Zwitter ion molecule. If you optimize this in the gas phase, there is nothing to say about. It makes immediately these kind, it makes immediately this kind of step. You see it. The proton immediately transfers from the ammonium group to the carbonyl group, and it is stabilizing the neutral form in the gas phase. And this is a very, very general kind of behavior. If you have Zwitter ions, you have them in the gas phase, and they somehow can become neutral, they usually do this without any barrier. Everything else is a large surprise. So now what you can do in this QMMM, you can put this into a kind of MM bubble of water molecules. This is still not a molecule in solution because, as you can see, the number of water molecules around, this is more like a sphere, so is a finite number. So you don't have an infinite system. So this is not a molecule in solution. This is an assembly of these glycine inside a water bubble. If you look at this from a thermodynamic point of view, it's a canonical simulation, a setup NVT, it's not NPT. No? So you have constant volume, which in this case is infinite. So, but besides this, I would like to point your attention to something more important here for the solute. This here is the glycine in its neutral form. You see here the carboxyl group, and you see here the amine group. If you put this in water, you get a little bit of, and you optimize, you get a little bit of relaxation inside the glycine. You see this at the beginning, it relaxes a little bit, and you have a very small relaxation of the water surrounding. Now, if you look at the right-hand side, this is now the Zwitter ion put into water, and the fundamental difference here is, first of all, to the gas phase calculation, that inside the optimization, the Zwitter ion remains stable. That doesn't mean that the Zwitter ion remains stable forever. This is not a molecular dynamic simulation. This is only an optimization of the system in an environment. But you already see that it is not collapsing as in the gas phase. And the other point, which is, I think, even more important for what we have in mind, is that if you look at the surrounding of the water of this Zwitter ion, you see here a much larger rearrangement inside the water as you have here. And the reason for that is obvious. This is a dipole moment, actually a quite strong dipole moment, you put into this polar environment, and the polar environment now adjusts to this dipole moment. And that is, in fact, creating entropy changes. Yeah? And that is exactly the solvent entropy that we are after, which is important to obtain the free energy solvent energies. The solvent free energy. Okay, now I got it. The solvent free energy. Yeah. So that is the important part we have to capture, and you see that there is this movement around here, and of course This will influence this local dipole moment inside here. It will critically influence also the molecular dynamics of these surrounding water molecules. Okay, I think we are at a point where I make a small break again, and I come back now to the possibility of questions and discussions. So, do you have some questions, some comments on this part of the presentation so far? I have to open the chat as usual.
Good morning, Professor. I have a question.
Yeah.
What kind of software do you employ to make this kind of animation?
This is I think that this was done with Gmol. This animation which I showed you there. Also usually what I'm using is Molden, very plain. But I think in this particular case, this was done by Juan Diego, and he uses either Gmol or VMD. No, I think, sorry, it was VMD. This was VMD. This is also an open source software, which can be interfaced easily to Daemon.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, okay. So here's another question from Victor. Can we calculate with this technique QMMM the oxidation state of a material? As, for example, in XPS characterization. Yes, we can. We can actually, also some people use QMMM in material science. You have to be, of course, a little bit careful for the MM part. Also, I'm not so sure that OPLS is then the best force field. But if you have a force field for materials, and they are there, I'm not so familiar with them, but I'm pretty sure they are there, you can use these force fields, and then you can calculate inside the QM region oxidation states. You can simulate XPS spectra inside QM regions. That is straightforward to do. All the techniques are there. Okay, other question here. How do the near and far field regions in the sum of the three center integrals are determined? Okay, that is a very good question. The determination is as follows. We do have an atomic radius for the orbitals. So we know how far the orbitals extend in space until their contribution to the density is below a fixed threshold. So we use for this 10 to the minus 10 atomic units. So then you have extensions for the orbitals. And we also know the potential around the point charge when this potential can be expressed in terms of a point moment expansion. So because here it is a point charge, it can be directly by its Cartesian coordinates expressed. So the situation is, here we have the quantum mechanical, one of the quantum mechanical atoms. We have around this quantum mechanical atom an radius which tells us how far we have to go outside until we see this quantum mechanical, until we can see this quantum mechanical atom charge distribution in terms of point charge distribution. And if the MM atom is outside this radius, we can have a point charge interaction. And that is then when we use far field three center integrals. This is very advantageous if you compare to fast multiple methods, because we do not need any kind of space division. We obtain the space division by the molecular structure of the QMMM system. So we have no overhead in terms of space division. Okay. Okay, other question here. In a model of DFT, should be considered the growth technique of a material, because, for example, growth of zinc oxide with, CVD. I don't remember actually what CVD was, but I think it's a surface technique, right, for the growth. Will not have the same properties than zinc oxide grown by pyrolysis plasma oxidation. Yeah, absolutely. And that is a very important issue where the calculations need actually the input of the experiment. You need ja at a point to build the atomistic model, and there you need to know which atomistic model is most appropriate for experiment. And particularly if you have, for example, different phases, I think that is where you, what this question of Victor is going to. If you have different phases, then you need to, also zinc blender and wurtzit structure, for example, you can make the best calculation in the zinc blender. If the experiment was done on the wurtzit structure, your calculations will not fit with the experiment. So that is absolutely important. And that is also something that is completely outside the range of any theoretical simulation. That is something we cannot predict. By no means in the moment. Okay, good. Other questions, other comments, comments. Also, as I said, in Spanish or in Spanish written.
I have a question.
Sure, go ahead.
I wanted to ask, I didn't understand very well what was the advantage that you told us about in the part where you explained to us the simulation, the QMMM simulation from the solute and the solvent to improve the simulation. I remember you told us you were wanting to modulate the solvent with quantum mechanics and then make that solvent interact with the same solvent in molecular mechanics. Was that it, the case?
Okay, maybe that was not coming out too clear. Also, in the moment, the QMMM simulations that have been done in order to calculate solvation energies have usually used an QM system that was maybe a ion or a molecule. And then all the solvent around was MM. And the results, quantitative results of these calculations are really very bad compared to PCM solvation energies. And one of the reasons why we believe, also this is a hypothesis, these results are so bad is because we have a direct interaction between the QM solute and the solvent. So to make this a little bit less abrupt, change from QM to MM, one suggestion could be to have a layer of QM solvent molecules. So think about you dissolve an gold cation in water. So this gold cation makes a bonding to the water. And in fact, it makes at the beginning to the first water molecules, it makes a dative bonding. So this is really a chemical bonding. If you have this water now described as an MM water, the description of this dative bonding is extremely bad. And this gives you very bad solvation energies or hydration energies. But if you take this water as a QM water, and you have the gold cation also as a QM gold cation, you have a very good description of this dative bonding, and then the MM water start further outside of the system. That is the idea which I try to lay out. Does this answer your question?
Okay. So the yes, I think I understand it better. So the direct interaction with the solvent and the molecule is with quantum mechanics.
Genau, exactly. And the point is that this is something we can do quite easily because we can calculate in QM region, which let's say 50 atoms or 100 atoms is for us very fast. But if you use Gaussian and you have a QM region with 50 or 100 atoms, the calculation becomes already quite clumsy. And if you have to do these calculations again and again and again, because you have some dynamics involved, then you try to make the QM region as small as possible. And I think that is the difference what we can offer with the speed of Demon compared to other calculations. Okay.
Oh, okay. And then the outer layers are the molecular mechanics solvent.
Exact. The outer layers are molecular mechanics. And also, I mean, this I will show you in a moment with the free energy gradients. What we will try to do is the inner layer, we will try to optimize. So we will use local optimization techniques for the inner layer. So the inner layer does not have dynamics. And the reason we hope that this can work is if you think about ion solutions, the first hydration shell is very stable. You actually can measure the hydration shells by X-ray diffractions in solvent. So the first hydration shell is very stable. It holds for probably nanoseconds or longer. And the dynamics starts outside this first hydration shell. So this is the reason why we hope that we can use local optimization techniques for these first hydration shells and the dynamics we use for the outer hydration shells. That is the experimental evidence which we hope that we can, I mean, show in this picture. As I told you, there is a question mark behind this. If this really works, we do not know. This is why we do the science, right?
Okay. It will get much clearer, Professor. Thank you.
Okay, good. Very well. Okay, I have here another question that is from Alfredo. That is, okay, Zwitter ion species are only stable in solvent. Also, in 99% this is true. There are some very weird Zwitter ions that are stable in gas phase, but they have very special electronic structure, setup in order to stabilize them. So in general, if you see a Zwitter ion and you say it's only stable in solvent, you have a very high success rate in your answer. If you repeat the calculation in the gas phase, you will obtain the neutral structure. Right, that is exactly that what you saw there. So the proton simply will move from the ammonium on the right-hand side to the carboxyl on the left-hand side. Okay. Other questions?
Just a comment.
Yeah, comment is also good, of course.
All the amino acids are in Zwitterion form. So if we want to make some biological systems, we need to introduce these solvent effects, right?
Yeah. Yeah. It's even more interesting. Also, if you think about this, these Zwitter ions have what is called an isoelectronic point. So you can find, this is now old chemistry knowledge, so I hope I don't say something completely stupid, but over the tuning of the pH, you can change the Zwitter ion in a neutral form, as I remember. This is, I think, the isoelectronic point. And ultimately, if you have one amino acid, you have one ammonium group and you have one carboxyl group, so that is not a big deal. But now think about a more complex protein. I mean, for example, this polymerase I have shown you there from COVID-19. If that has, on the outside, maybe 100 or more carboxyl groups and as many of these ammonium groups. And all of these groups have different isoelectronic points. So that means if you put this into a certain environment, several of these acid groups are deprotonated and several of these base groups are protonated. And these gives, if you think about locally, charges. And that means if they are far away in this molecule, you obtain large dipole moments. So the knowledge of what is protonated, what is deprotonated in this biochemical systems is of outermost importance for their physiological actions. And that is a big field of unknown research in the moment. When we do these calculations, we assume certain protonation states. And this might be completely wrong. Yeah. Okay, here's another question. Is it possible to do umbrella sampling with QMMM? Yes, of course. And in the moment, if you are going for free energies, Ricardo, then umbrella sampling is a method of choice. This is also done in some of these. There are some tutorials for DMON, for QMMM calculations. I think umbrella sampling is one of them. I personally would like to avoid umbrella sampling, I must say, because it's extremely, extremely time consuming. So we are talking about 50,000, 100,000 calculations, maybe for one sampling point. So let's say it so. I mean, it would be great if we could do the umbrella sampling without doing the QM calculations again and again and again. Because if we do umbrella sampling only with the MM, it is extremely fast. But if we have to do in the umbrella sampling in each sampling step also a QM calculation, then it becomes really a nightmare. Okay. Other questions or comments? That seems not to be the case. Okay, so then I will now go back to the presentation and we continue in that. So let me, okay. So this here is actually something which directly addresses the last question about umbrella sampling. As I said in my answer, I just had an email from a guy, Bernie Hagler, who wants to do this. I gave him some time estimates and he simply said this is 10 times too slow for what we want to do. Yeah, that is the situation. Okay, so let us think if there is any way out of this to obtain free energies in a way that not in each of these sampling steps we have to do a QM calculation. So let's go back to our system in the most simple form. I mean, I will not now address these first hydration shell or so, because I would like to keep the discussion as simple as possible. So the idea is the following. We are interested in free energy. That means we need to incorporate T times S. So we need to incorporate entropic contributions. So if we look at these systems, then we can ask ourselves, from where can come these entropic contributions? From where comes the most part of the entropic contribution? And let's say we are at room temperature. What we know is that, for example, for such a propane, we can calculate inside in gas phase, we can calculate the atomization energy of these propane in gas phase, and we will get rather good results. We then can incorporate here on the basis of a frequency analysis And I mean thermodynamic functions in harmonic approximations. That is simple statistical thermodynamics, as you can read in physical chemistry textbooks with harmonic oscillators and so on. And we know that with this kind of approach, for this molecule here, we will obtain a decent description of its binding energies. So the entropic contribution that is really solvent specific and difficult to capture must come from this stuff here. And the idea of free energy gradients is now to build gradients of the energy. This is the QMMM energy. But now to derive these QMMM energy only with respect to the nuclear coordinate position of these QM system. So these will change, this embedding of these QM system inside the solvent will change, of course, the structure. This change might be not too much, but it is energetically in the range of a few kilocalories per mole. And if we optimize this structure now in such a form, we obtain this change. But what do we do during this optimization with the solvent? So one possibility is we can keep the solvent fixed, or we optimize also the solvent with it, as I have shown you before. Inside these QMMM calculations for the glycine, but then the entropic contribution of the solvent we do not have. If we want to calculate this entropic contribution of the solvent in a similar form as we do standard for the calculation of such an isolate molecule, we would need to calculate the frequencies of all of these systems. So of this system here. So this is a big job, even if you have a good frequency calculations, but this is a big job. So an idea is then, instead of doing this large frequency calculation, instead of calculating this gradient here in one solvent geometry, sample this gradient here for different solvent geometries. So do a molecular mechanics on the solvent, keeping, however, the QM part frozen. So this is what I mean here, what I pointed out here. In the calculation of these, this is a sampling, this is a mean value. In these mean value calculations, the QM structure stays frozen during the molecular mechanics MD simulation. That is the idea. And of course, as before, we don't need any cupping potentials or link atoms. Then, however, this sampling, if we are interested in hydration energies, this sampling must be performed in the NPTM ensemble. It must be performed under constant pressure, because if we would do this under NVT and we sample this after some time, these water molecules outside here would simply evaporate and they would go away. And in order to do an NPT ensemble, we need to have an extended MM system. So we need somehow now to introduce the situation that we really want not to go to such an ensemble, but we want to go into really the solution where the amount of these water molecules around this solute becomes infinite. Yeah. So these are the two parts we have to develop. This idea has been published really many years ago, more than 25 years ago. It was one of the last works and one of the last ideas Fukui has pursued, in not even in his group, but in the institute he had, and it was pursued by people around Nagaoka. In the last 5 years or so, there are two publications to my knowledge of this approach in the literature. They are both done by the group of Weitao Yang in a very crude implementation on a very experimental level. If you read these papers, they don't say it works or it doesn't work. They simply say we have done something, we have obtained these results, we really don't know if it works or it doesn't work. So to conclude, this is blank territory. This is unknown ground. So let us think of how we can calculate these kind of gradients. So as I told you, this is an assembling of gradients. This is an sampling of gradients. So we have to calculate these gradients for different molecular mechanics structures again and again and again and again. And then we take an average out of these gradients. And with this gradient average, we make a movement of the QM structure. And then we do it again, and we sample again the MM molecular dynamics. We take a new average, and we take a new movement of the QM structures. So it's a combination of molecular dynamics and local optimization. Molecular dynamics of the MM structure, local optimization of the QM solute structure, maybe with a first hydration shell. Okay, these gradients in green are all no problem. They are analytic. They go just fast without any problems. Actually, this gradient does not even exist because it's totally molecular mechanics. The problem really is this gradient part here, the derivative of the QM energy with respect to the positions of the QM atoms. So in the implementations that Weitao has shown, and in the original suggestions, it was, admitted that for each change in the MM structure, so for each MM step here in the molecular dynamics, a new SCF calculation has to be done, because the term that is augmented to the core Hamiltonian has changed. And as a result, the density will change. And in order to understand how this density changes, I need to go again through the SCF. So this makes these calculations incredibly expensive and cumbersome. And that is the reason why nobody is looking into that. We have, however, an idea. Now I did a mistake, sorry. That was not good. Do you see my slide?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, so this is where we were. I forgot to bring it into presentation mode. We have, however, an idea that is the following. Instead of doing these SCFs again and again and again and again, could we not use perturbation theory? Could we not consider the change in this MM environment as a perturbation to the local small QM system? The big advantage is that the response matrix of the QM system only depends on the structure of the QM system. It does not depend on the structure of the MM environment. Yeah. So because the structure of the QM system in all of these MM steps remains the same, this response matrix doesn't change. You need to calculate this response matrix only one time. And the only thing that continuously change is the perturbation vector, because the perturbation vector now incorporates the changes in the MM environment. That means that instead of running an SCF for each of these MM steps, you only would to have to solve these inhomogeneous equation system for each of these MM steps. That is a big difference. And these response matrix, you would not recalculate. You would calculate this response matrix one time and you store it on disk. So you have no necessary integral calculations on the left-hand side here of this equation system. You have some integral calculations on the right-hand side. That is something we are coming into a moment. But this will be much less computational demanding than running through the full SCF procedure again and again and again. So the idea is then to expand the QM energy in terms of the MM coordinates. This is this delta D, and you make this expansion up to second order. That is the idea, and the derivatives that you obtain here, they are calculated then by perturbation theory. So you switch from self-consistent solutions to perturbation theory. That is the fundamental idea we have. That is our, let's say, contribution to this field, which nobody has done so far. So if you evaluate these two gradients here, or these two, sorry, derivatives here, you see that the first derivative, as usual, remember 2n plus 1, we are at n equals 0. So that means we can get the first derivative for free. And in fact, the first derivative only is calculated in terms of such integrals. These are electric field integrals. They can be calculated right away. We can use asymptotic expansions for them. This is something we know very well how to do. The second derivative is shown here. These integrals, this term here is also an integral term. It is electric field gradient integrals. The same what I told about this term is here. This is not a problem. We know how to do this rather fast. And if you ask how much is the time for calculating these integrals or these sums here compared to an SCF time, then the difference is by orders of magnitude. I mean, factor 10, 100, or maybe even 1,000. It depends on how good the SCF is converging, how large your system is, it's so much. But the factors are huge. These are large factors. So these two terms are easy. We know how to do this. Here, however, is a problem. As we had discussed this already yesterday for perturbation theory, this is a density matrix. This we have from the initial SCF of our system, but this is a perturbed density matrix. And this perturbed density matrix now changes with the position of the MM atoms. So at this level, it would mean we would need a perturbation for each MM atom. Then the thing would be dead. That would be not possible. That would be worse than SCF calculations, probably. But what we can do is we can rewrite these equations and we can put the movement of all MM atoms together into one perturbation. I call this the collective perturbation. And then we need these perturbed density matrix only for each MM step, independent of how many MM atoms we consider. We can have 10 million MM atoms. We need only one perturbed density matrix. And this one perturbed density matrix can be calculated directly from ADPT with the response matrix we take from tape. So this looks attractive from a computational point of view. And this is possible. And then if you write this down, the whole energy expansion to second order looks like this. The first two terms, also of the expansion, this one and this one, are no problem, and they are straightforward to be calculated. And the problem is here in this third term, of course, because you now need here the perturbed density matrix. And this is then calculated over ADPT with a response matrix taken from tape. So this approach here, comparing, coming back to umbrella sampling, has the following fundamental conceptually advantage. It defines something that, I mean, now all the people who are experts in statistical mechanics, please close your ears. I call free energy surface. So this is a term. If you talk to statistical people from statistical mechanics, they are shortly to shoot you when you say this. But it is a term that has been used in chemistry really since ages, and it is the idea that you have an internal energy surface, as we have the potential energy surface, and you simply put the entropic contribution on top of this surface. I'm aware that this is not a very well formulated mathematical topic, but it has conceptually a meaning in chemistry. This free energy surface, if you allow me to use this term, has minima and has transition states. So now you can combine, by having these free energy gradients, you can combine local optimization and transition finding techniques, intrinsic reaction coordinates, and so on. Everything you have on the internal energy surface, you now can combine with the sampling of your molecular mechanics environment. And this would bring us into a completely different scaling regime, because we would not now try to obtain reaction coordinates by molecular dynamics, as you do in umbrella sampling, because molecular dynamics is not aimed towards a reaction. I mean, this is why in umbrella sampling you need the constraints that you bring something up to the free energy path. And here you would have directly gradients which you search the minimum energy path, now the minimum energy path on the free energy surface, to obtain the transition state. So that would greatly simplify these kind of calculations. So this is the idea of free energy gradients. This is really something we don't know if it will work or not. There are several assumptions here that are critical to that this can work, and we don't know how good these assumptions are. But if it works, it really will bring us into a different ballpark of simulations. So this is the situation in a graphical scheme, how we are inside Daemon 2K with QMMM and with the free energy gradient calculations. The big advantage which we have compared to let's say scripting-based QMMM approaches is that our energy models that are here in the top, so the quantum mechanical energy models and the molecular mechanic energy models, they are feeding into the same gradient vector. Yeah, and if you now combine this with the ADPT part here, you can think about that they are feeding into the same free energy gradient. And once we would have these free energy gradients, we could use them in the same way as gradients. So we could make now local structure optimizations, transition state search, frequency analysis, intrinsic reaction coordinates, and instead of using gradients, we use free energy gradients. So that would be greatly simplifying exploration of potential energy surface. Of course, we could think about something completely crazy. we could feed the free energy gradients back into a BOMD. It's possible. It's extremely costly, of course, but in principle it's possible. And in this way, we would collect all non-harmonic and entropic contributions inside the system. That is, of course, I mean, an ultimate goal. But that would be computationally very demanding. What we are needing and what I would like to discuss here is we need the implementation of a barostat because we are interested really quantitatively in the calculation of solvation energies, hydration energies in this particular case. And for this, we need NPT ensemble in the for the molecular dynamics to calculate the free energy gradients. And in order to obtain the NPT, we somehow need periodic boundary conditions, and we will introduce that inside or with the cyclic cluster model. So let me break here for a moment and coming back to some sections now about questions and comments.